What's up, guys? Simply Shredded, part 4 of 5 here. This one's gonna go into more about the recovery process from the gym, because we don't grow in the gym. We don't grow while we're lifting. We grow when we come at the gym and we recover and rest and repair those muscles. When we go to the gym, man, the smallest point of the muscle belly, right, is called a sarcomere. Inside of that, a protein filament is called actin and myosin. There's 3 actin and 2 myosin in the smallest form, right? There's cross bridges that connect those two. When we contract our muscle, the cross bridges bring the actin protein filaments over the myosin ones. And as we start lifting them, we rip the cross bridges, making a separation there. That separation, all this blood goes, that's a pump, and you're feeling that so alive and that great high you get in there. Well, that's when it rips and they separate. So you must then rest to have these things grow back, elongate, to get back to their original protein actin and myosin filaments. That is elongation of muscle. That's the growth we want. Overtraining is going to make these things, there's millions of them, guys. So when we rip these things, right, these can go either to the original ones at the point of origin where they rip from, or they can digress to something right next to it, even closer. So what I'm trying to say is that if you guys are overtraining, in essence, you can get weaker. We're going to go into a lot of things. We're going to overtraining. We're going to go into the DOMS effect, that delayed onset muscle soreness that we get, that feeling. We're going to get injuries from the gym. Are you injured or are you just hurt? We're going to go into different elements of heat and ice at bat. Which one's better there? We're going to do self-prognosis with the rice factor of rest and ice and compression and elevation. So we got a lot to go into, a lot more from my site, guys, but I'm going to just speed through this and get through as much as I can and give you guys some information on really how to recover after the workout. That X factor that we just put into ourselves, that great lifting we just did, to get the most bang for the buck. Make sure we get all the work that we did in the gym turned into principle of muscle growth, whatever our goals in the gym are, that we get all that. We just did the work, now let's get paid for the work, right? If you guys are coming out of the gym and you're not resting, that's the equation, right? You have your the 4 equations, you know, with lifting and then your cardio and your diet and nutrition and then your rest, they all hold equal weight. If you just lift every minute of the day, you're gonna get weaker, guys. You gotta have time to rest and recover. So let's really get smart here to know what the recovery process is so we can optimize our efforts in the gym. Okay, so back to what I was saying, those actin and myosin filaments, when we rip them, the overtraining aspect is this. There's millions of them, so they either go back to the point of origin or they're just gonna go back to the closest one. So if we rip them and now we're supposed to rest, right? But we don't. We overtrain. We get back in there first. We get back in there again before they've totally grown back, right? What happens right here? They won't grow back. They'll go back to something closer. And hence, shortening the muscle belly, making yourself weaker. Overtraining, guys, like I'm speaking English to you guys, there's a body language that your body is telling you every single day. It's like a baby. A baby's crying and everything else, and I'm like, oh, what's wrong? But it can't speak English. We have to guess what that is. We're trying to learn the baby's language and what the crying is. What's causing that discomfort in the baby? You know, so people pick up the baby, they start petting it and stuff, they give it food, they start singing songs. Maybe the baby's like, yo, my shoe's too tight, man, loosen it up. Maybe that's the problem, we don't know. But the more we learn the language of the baby, the more we can assess what's wrong and fix the problem. Same with our bodies. Our bodies are always telling us something in the gym. We might go into the gym and be like, man, I just don't feel alive today. I don't know what it is. Your body's telling you something right there. Or we're going to the gym, we're feeling lightheaded, or getting dizzy, or you know, our energy levels are down, or like, you don't feel the pump or anything, or everything just feels heavy. All these things are languages. Like, I'm speaking in English, guys. It's telling you, yo, listen to me, motherfucker. I'm trying to tell you something. The quicker we can learn that language of our body, understand what it is saying to us, apply what we know that means, we can marry each other into success a lot faster. The mind-body connection is not just a high, it's an education process of knowing how our body works, applying the fundamental principles to our body to make it enhance the best we can, okay? So don't negate those principles that your body is saying to you. People are like, oh man, you ain't training unless you're puking, or you ain't training unless it's raining. All these you know, egotistical people, it's their pride talking, guys. Mentally tough is very is good. You want to be strong. You want to push past adversity. When you're feeling like, oh man, I 2 more, let's go, let's get it. That's all positive, but there's a fine line between, you know, that kind of energy level and then being stupidity. Courage and stupidity, fine line. Same with like love and hatred, extreme emotions, fine line between the two of them. So we gotta make smart decisions here. Overtraining. What is the definition of overtraining? Overtraining is nothing more than your physical activity, whatever it is. The level of your physical activity, right, exceeds the level of your physical recovery. That's all it is, guys. So it means when you're going in there and you're ripping those actin and myosin filaments, boom, you're not giving enough time to grow back. You're going in there too soon. You're jumping the gate too soon. I know you guys are, you know, you're like, hey man, if the more I hit it, the faster I'll grow and everything else. Yes, in a way, it's a very fair society in the gym. No one gives it to you, take it away. It's yours to win or lose, right? It all comes down to what you want to do with your hands and drive your body into the dream reality of what you want to live. But you have to be smart. You can't go too fast too soon. It's a marathon, guys, not a sprint. If you sprint it out and try to do too much too soon, a lot of things are going to happen. You're going to overtrain, right? So you can actually get weaker. You're going to burn out. You're going to cause injury. Injury, what is injury all about? Are you injured or are you hurt? Two totally different things. If it's an acute injury, right? Meaning like a strain, or maybe you got bruised or something, or just, you know, you torn something or a slight tear, injured. If you're hurt, that means, man, no matter what you do, man, you've got to take time off. A doctor's got to come in, evaluate the situation, apply medicine or therapy or physical therapy to help that before you can get back. You're not 100%. If you continue to work out while you're actually hurt, all you would do is enhance that problem. And it's like a fucking herpes, you know? It's a gift that keeps on giving. You never get out of that. You always be working around it. You never get 100%. You know, if you're gonna go into something, go 100%. Otherwise, you know, your true potential is never gonna be reached. So injury, we have to do self-assessments, guys. So if you go to the gym, and by the way, everyone's injured, guys. It's called life. I cannot tell you one time in my life that I've gone to the gym where I've been 100% across the board. I always had some kind of bruise or a pull or a strain or soreness or, you know, maybe just a headache or just, you know, mentally my mind somewhere else. There's always different things going on, you know, but you push through that. So I want to tell you guys, just man up and push through it. But there's a fine line between that because, you know, yes and no, right? If you're injured, guys, if you keep pushing it past that point, you're not gonna, yeah, you're tough, you're mentally tough, but you're just gonna cause an injury to keep reoccurring, reoccurring, reoccurring. And so your workouts are gonna start digressing and digressing and digressing. And then all of a sudden, the worst thing's gonna happen is mentally you're gonna start thinking, man, this sucks. You know, what am I doing, man? I'm not getting results, I'm putting all this work in, I'm not getting the back end return. You know, what am I doing? This, fuck this, I'm out of here. And you're done. Your confidence goes to shit, you feel like a failure. All from one little injury because we didn't assess the problem. So, when you guys go into the gym and you feel something like, oh, I don't know what's happening there, my back's a little sore or whatever else, maybe it's minimal. Maybe it's just an acute little strain, a little acute injury, something we can fix on our own. Maybe it's more. Let's find out. How do we do that? Okay, well, you start, let's say it's my shoulder, right? My shoulder is kind of feeling all bummed out and everything else. Let's say it's red, it's sore, it's point tender and everything else. Well, that's soreness and everything else, the redness. The pain we feel is inflammation around what's injured. The pain isn't injured. The pain is just giving you the emotional knowledge that something's wrong here. And then it's all red and everything else. That's your visual representation. So when you go to the doctor, you say, yo, it's fucked up right here, man. Something's wrong, you know? But before we go into the doctor, give it a week and test it out. So how do we test it out? It's a RICE principle, R-I-C-E. It's an acronym meaning rest, ice, compression, and elevation. So first thing we do is we gotta rest it. If you feel that problem, you know, you guys can still go to the gym, but you gotta tell your workouts around that injury so the injury is protected, so you're not causing more damage to what could be already severely damaged or acutely damaged, okay? So rest is very important. Second thing is ice. Ice, what's heat and what's ice? All right, it's two different things. Before you go into a workout, that's when you want to do heat. Before an activity is heat, you know, half an hour before. If I have a little bit of a pull or something I'm working through or something, I don't think it's something serious, I need to get checked out by a professional doctor. You know, what I'll do in this test period, I'll get some Icy Hot, some Bengay, Flexol 454, some kind of cream, put it on there. You know, half an hour going into the gym, get the heat going, get that blood moving and circulation going. That's what you do before the workout. Maintain that through the workout. As soon as your workout's over, that's when you ice it down. And when you ice it down, it's like a bag of ice, 20 minutes or something else. Better than a bag of ice, guys, go get these plastic little cups. I mean, paper little cups, right? Put ice in there about halfway up. Cups this big, halfway up. Put them in the freezer. Have a bunch of them in there always, right? When you have a problem, right, in the shoulder, grab that ice after your workout. Peel off the paper. So there's this much paper and this much ice, right? So you have a little ice cup. And then you're gonna put that on there and you're gonna massage the ice into it. It's better than an ice pack. The ice pack is only so much surface area of cold compression hitting it. When you have a thing of ice and you're massaging it, it goes deeper into whatever the targeted problem is to really help slow down the blood and the inflammation, the swelling of it, so you can, it can recover faster. So that's the ice. The next thing is compression. If you have an ace bandage or something, wrap that guy up. Keep compression on there. It'll help the inflammation, help the swelling, keep it controlled. Last thing is elevation. Gravity is your friend. Lift it high, man. Let that gravity start pulling all the inflammation out, all the swelling and everything else. So we test it out. We see what it is. Also, stretching is very important. Well, why is stretching important? Or any kind of light cardio? Because it increases your wind, right? So you're increasing your circulatory, and you start moving blood through. So you're moving, different elements, minerals, and vitamins to help repair that. Your white blood cells and everything else. Same with stretching. You're elongating the muscle, opening up different channels to get more blood in there. It's going to help out. But let's say over time, man, we're still feeling that pain. It's not going away or everything else. Gotta get it checked out, man. Period. Gotta get it checked out. I know too many people, including myself, that have just been too stupid at times and said, I'll push through it, push through it, push through it. Right now, I got a bum shoulder on my, that's what I'm doing, I got a bum shoulder still. And I went to the doctor because I went for a while, and it's actually something that I can't fix. It's something that surgery has to go and do it later in life. Now, why did it happen? Genetics, I don't know, overtraining, going too hard when I was early on before I was really smart about all this stuff. So hopefully you guys can learn from my mistakes and find that problem that probably existed, 5, 6, 10 years ago, and I didn't address it properly, so now I have a problem here. I can still go, but one day it's gonna fucking hit, and then I'm gonna have to go get some surgery. I'll be out for a couple months. And doesn't that suck? Because when you're out, guys, when you have an injury and you keep pushing and pushing and pushing it, what will happen is you push yourself into the hospital bed, or push yourself at the gym for 2 months, and what happens there is we get this mental problem in our heads, this depression that, man, before that mind-body connection was so strong because I felt alive when I went to the gym. I felt like I was on top of the world. Now all of a sudden I'm bedlined, I'm sidelined, I can't get to be part of it. And what my medicine, what pulled me out of the depression, that physical activity of work, dealing with stress in a physical state is no longer an arsenal in my weaponry. I can't use that because I've injured myself. I wasn't smart. So now I'm just sitting there thinking about how much it sucks and I can't do anything. It's like my hands are tied, Then depression starts hitting in, and then one thing, a domino effect, hits another aspect of your life to another aspect of your life, then you're just buried in a hole, man. The dead of life. Depression doesn't heal itself, guys. All right. So, but then again, when we go to the gym also, if you guys haven't worked out for a while, you get something called a Dom's effect, and everyone gets this. If you haven't worked out for about a week, or you're doing a totally different workout, something you haven't done, for example, I tell guys on the site, if you guys have ever gone rock climbing, you've never gone rock climbing, and after that rock climbing routine, that workout of rock climbing, you can't write your name, because you've used so many different muscles in your forearm you've never used before, they're so sore, and you're like, oh my god, what happened? Or if you just hit legs really hard, and you try to sit on the john, you're like, whoa! And you go crash into the toilet because you don't have the strength anymore because it's so sore. I mean, sore like point tender. You touch it and you're like, whoa, man. Someone gives you a hug. You're like, whoa, dude, man, you're killing me here. They're like, what's wrong with you? It's called a Dom's effect, a delayed onset muscle soreness. It's common. You can't do anything about it. It's your body saying, yo, you just kicked my ass, man. I wasn't ready for that. I need a little more time to repair. It's, they say 12 to 72 hour rule. It's really a 48 hour rule. So if I work out this morning, right, to cause that Dom's effect in a workout I haven't done before, I won't feel the side effects from that until the next day. Not the next one, the morning after, the 48 hour rule. So the next morning I might be sore. The real soreness is gonna come kick me in the ass the morning after the first morning, okay? Now how do we get rid of that Dom's effect, and how do we, it's gonna go away with time. Can we work out through that? Yes, we can. We can continue to work out. That's gonna help it because it's gonna increase the blood flow, doing light weight, high reps, push through that. Sports massage is really good at that time to really push all that lactic acid and the soreness out of it. Taking any kind of anti-inflammatory, Motrin and stuff like that helps out. Make sure you take it on a full stomach. Your cardio is going to be really good because it's going to increase your blood flow and everything else. So stay in a proactive state in that Dom's effect. Don't just sit there and just let it just soak in, man. Keep moving, exercising it. It's going to help that. They say it takes up to sometimes 7 days. But if you guys are more proactive and doing these different measures, those 7 days are going to be more like, 3 days. Also, when you're doing, when you haven't worked out for guys for a while, and especially beginners who maybe this year's New Year's resolution is, hey man, I'm gonna go and really change my life this year, and they're going to the gym and spend about a week or two, now they're feeling really sore. Well, it's because you really haven't worked out before. So knowing that next time is you wanna hit every major muscle group as fast as you can, so that that delayed onset muscle soreness that happens for 3 days, it happens universally at the same body. So you're not doing chest and then taking 3 days off, then doing back and taking another 3 days off. You know, see how long that can go? If we go in there and do a circuit train, we hit it hard to rip up the major heads of every muscle group, hitting the chest, back, shoulders, arms, legs, all within like a 2 day span, then that down stress can come kick you, right? But it's not gonna kick you for 3 or 4 days, and then you're gonna be totally fresh. As long as you stay on that current path of working out on a frequency basis, you won't have that DOMS effect again. But so then people are like, well, am I really getting a good workout if I don't have that DOMS effect? Am I shocking my muscles up enough if I'm not feeling that DOMS effect in there? Yes, you are, guys. You don't need a DOMS effect. You don't need the extreme every single workout. It's the burn we're going after, guys, not the soreness. You know, the burn means you're actually pushing your muscles past the point of the current limitation, past failure and beyond. That's the growth right there, guys. You don't need soreness the next day to say good job, you know what I mean? The DOMS effect is going to come whenever you switch your workout up. If you're on a frequency basis and you're going to the gym every single day on a nice pattern and everything else, when you shock that workout up, guys, when you shock that workout up, it's something new your body's not ready for. DOMS effect will come start setting in and saying, yo, you got me, man. I don't like that. I'm going to get stronger for you so we don't have that again. So the more times you keep shocking it, the faster it grows, kind of like the blogger did for you guys before. It's like, you can't stay in that comfort zone of life, guys. You can't just do the same thing over and over and over again. Same with eating, guys. If you do the same workout over and over again, and you eat the same way over and over again, and you're like, dude, I keep going to the gym and everything, I'm not growing. You're not gonna grow, guys. Your body's smarter than you think it is. It's gonna find a more efficient way to do the exact same workout, which will take away from your end state results of growth, guys. It's two steps ahead of you. Same with eating, and everyone's like, well, what about, do you ever cheat meals? You must have cheat meals, guys. Whoever says you shouldn't have cheat meals, out of your fucking mind. When you guys are eating clean, right? Or no matter how you're eating right now, if you take a snapshot of how you're eating, your eating habits right now, that's normality, right? Your body knows that normality. It goes, boom, I'm used to this, right? Same way we shock our system, our physique outside, I mean the external factor in the gym, we must do the same inside ourselves, in the internal factor inside our body. Okay, well, what does that mean? Well, if we're even eating clean, everything right, you know, low carb, high protein, low fat, eating real clean, you know, 4, 5, 6 meals a day, or that one big meal, whatever your end state goals are, if we don't change that up, it's gonna be have the same effect as if we don't change our workout up, meaning plateau, no longer rise. Because our body is getting used to it. It's like, no longer is it pass and go and collecting $200. It's just like straight to jail. I mean, the food's coming in, it knows exactly what the food is all the time. So it's like, oh yeah, same thing, go ahead, man, you're good, you're good. It's like a checkpoint on the street, you know, and you know Bob that works there. You come pulling in, you got a red car, and Bob knows you come at 7 o'clock every day. You come pulling up, and you just wave, hey, all right, man. Bob lets you right through, because you got a red car at the same time. Well, you come in at a different hour, or you come in a different car, hold up, Bob's holding you up. I'm like, yo, Bob, you know me. Oh, okay, yeah, good, good, good. Same with the food coming through your digestive tract. If it knows what it is all the time, it's like, yeah, we're good, boom, we're good, boom. All of a sudden, you throw a cheat meal in there, right? Well, what happens when it keeps saying, oh, we're good, we're good, we're good? Our metabolism just starts lowering itself because the body doesn't have to work as hard to break down the food. It knows the food, it's used to the food, it's the same diet and everything else. Our metabolism slows down. We don't want that. We want the metabolism high. Metabolism high is going to start burning up all the fat, get the nutrients into our body and everything else. So how do we keep it high? How do we keep raising that metabolism? Especially if we want to lose weight, guys, if that's your end state goal, that cheat meal. Now, a cheat meal doesn't mean, yo, hey, my cheat day or my cheat meal, so let me really indulge here and really just destroy my entire workout and diet routine on this one meal. No, it's simple, guys. It's not 4,000 calories in one sitting. It's just changing it up. Throw some sugars. Throw something in there you like to eat, you know? Something that satisfies the appetite. Because really, when you're eating, guys, it's not about satisfying the appetite. It's about fueling the body. But in a cheat meal, you want to do that. You want to throw in something your body's not used to. So when it comes down the pipe at that checkpoint where Bob's sitting there, he's like, whoa, what is all this stuff? All right. So we keep them sharp, right? Same with your body. Throwing those cheat meals, it keeps it sharp. So it always has to examine everything that's coming through because it doesn't know. Maybe it might change. keeps the metabolism high. Same with your workouts, you gotta keep that high. The other thing about this body language and everything else I'm telling you guys about, and I'm trying to go as fast as I can, there's so much I'm missing. Go to my site, everything's there, and a more like normal pace of talk. If you guys are feeling a little bit like when I go for a shoot, guys, I'm really dehydrated, carb depleted, and everything else. I'm in a state where I'm dizzy, I'm all over the place. But that's the price I will pay for the cover to look a certain way. Meaning, like I said in another blog, that the better the picture is directly correlated to the worse you kind of feel, because you're so depleted and everything else, and you have this fake smile like, I'm okay, but you're really just dying for this shit to be over, so you can replenish yourself with food and water and nutrients. I don't go into a workout at that state, you know. I don't go into a workout where I'm that dehydrated or anything else. That's not a walking everyday look, you know. That's just for a shooting a cover or whatever else. Yeah, you stay lean and everything else, but you have to stay at a performance grade, an optimal level, so that you can continue to grow and continue to improve. If you're that depleted, especially dehydrated, guys, you're gonna gas out fast. You're not gonna have the energy. You're not gonna get through that workout. So you're really going to start slowly lowering your potential of what you can be. Especially with hydration, guys. And hydration is not just drinking water, guys. It's not about just having water and everything else. It's electrolytes. When you guys do a muscle contraction, right? When I'm doing a muscle contraction here, right? That's an electric process within the body. Electrolytes, you know, the main ones are calcium, magnesium, and potassium. There are electric ions that consider it like in stupid simple English, a spark plug of your car. Those are the electrolytes. That's what you need, that spark plug to get the whole system started so you can move it, right? If you don't have those electrolytes, you really can't. You're taking yourself out of the game, guys. And real fast, I just forgot something else. The Dom's effect, guys. It comes on the eccentric contraction of your muscle, meaning, well, there's three types of contractions of your body. You have an isometric, a concentric, and an eccentric. An isometric would be something like if you're sitting here and you're flexing, right? You're just holding a form like this, right? Nothing's moving. There's no muscle elongating or shortening. That's an isometric contraction. If you sit on the wall and you do wall squats, isometric contraction. All posing, isometric. Very good, by the way, for especially if you're going to a shoot and stuff, to really burn that up and really striate and see all the things you have. The other one is a concentric contraction, the shortening of the muscle. So if I grab my arm, I'm doing bicep curl here, right? And I bring my arm up, I'm shortening the belly of my bicep right here, right? Shortening it. That's a concentric contraction. The opposite of that would be an eccentric contraction. It's a contraction of a muscle in an elongated state. So like the negative rep, you know, when you guys are doing negative reps or negative drop sets and stuff, or when I curl up, I'm bring the weight back down, you know. That's the eccentric contraction. The reason why I'm emphasizing the eccentric contraction, that is where all the Dom's effect comes, guys. It doesn't come in the isometric somewhat, not in the concentric, just in the eccentric, guys. The eccentric contraction right there, which is really good to know. So why is that? Because your body's not used to that. Everything's used to is lifting it up, not really letting it down, right? So think about your workouts. If you really want to grow and push past the failure, these drop sets and supersets are so crucial because it's shocking the system within the same universal lift that you guys have been doing. So you have a buddy in there that really pull that weight down. You just hold it up as much as you can do on a drop set. You get killer results. You will get the Dom's effect big time too. But that Dom's effect is just telling you, good job, man. You just killed it in the gym. Get ready for some growth. Growth doesn't happen, guys, in the gym. Again, 360, we're coming back to the end of this now. Does not happen in the gym. It happens after you come out in your rest and recovery period to make sure those actin and myosin filaments grow back to the point of origin of which they separated from, hence elongating the muscle. If you guys overtrain and stuff and you're not listening to your body's language, there's gonna be sometimes you're gonna go to the gym, you're like, man, I don't feel today, you know? Well, that might just be that you're lazy, you know? But it could be your body telling you something. I can't tell you what these things are definitively to you because they're independently, you know, the Baskin-Robbins 31 flavors, same with working out. We all have our own fingerprint. It's different for everybody, you know? The only way you guys can really learn this language is trial and error, going through the motions, seeing what this does and how your body reacts, what that does and how your body reacts. And you should be excited about that. That should be what yearns you to go into the gym and grow and get stronger. It's because it's not the same routine. You don't go to the movie and watch the same damn movie every single time, do you? No. You see different movies. Same with the gym. You gotta break the monotony, otherwise it becomes benign to you and you're bored with it. You cannot get bored in the gym. Always excited, always changing things up, seeing how your body reacts. It's like a, it's like a big hide and go seek, you know? Which exercise is gonna hit this one the best? Okay, and guess what? Once you find it, get ready for it to change because your body's two steps right there ahead of you, making it easier for you, so you gotta shock it up again. But again, the growth comes outside of the gym. So you really have to give it the right time of recovery. For a novice person, there's gonna be more recovery needed than somebody who is who's been experienced in the gym. But that's gonna change for everybody too. Find out what your optimal rest period is. Now, it doesn't mean to be days. You can tailor your workouts around different regimens so that you're doing chest one day. Like for me, I do a five-day split where I go chest, back, shoulders, arms, legs. Don't take a day off, so I go chest, then I go back, shoulders, arms, legs, then chest again on day six. So that's 4 days off for chest. Yes, I'm working a little bit of chest with shoulders. I'm hitting tries with chest and shoulders. So, you know, you tailor your workout around so you can always go into the gym, keep moving it, keep doing something different while recovering the major groups so they have a good 2 to 3 day window. Anyway, I hope that helps, man. Greg Plitt, helping you stay fit, man. SimplyShredded Part 4. We got one more coming to you at the end of this week. To wrap up the 5-part series. To see more of this, go to GregPlitt.com and check it out. Thanks for watching.